This is the story of a runaway, with no way home and no way out. I threw the best of me away. I had my chance, it's too late now. Too far gone and too ashamed to think that you'd still know my name. But love refused to let my story in that way. You didn't wait for me to find my way to you. I couldn't cross that distance, even if I wanted to. You came running after me when anybody else would have turned and left me at my worst. Love moved first. Grace, relentless grace, would chase this rebel down. Crawl into this prisoner's cage, take my hand and pull me out. You knew I couldn't make the change, so you became the change in me. And now I live to tell the story of the God who rescues. Love made the first move. You didn't wait for me to find my way to you. I couldn't cross that distance, even if I wanted to. You came running.
She said yes.
Mom, it's a boy.
Hey, Mom. Love you.
Well, good morning. We're glad to have you with us on this rather different Mother's Day than we're used to having around here at CBC. Normally, we would be just finishing up with our Mother's Day breakfast in which all the men would serve and just a joyous time together, and now here I am in an empty auditorium. And it's strange, but you know, with God's help, we're trying to make the best of it. But even though this is a different kind of Mother's Day, still, for those of you who are listening as mothers, one, we want to say to you, Happy Mother's Day. We want to say how grateful to the Lord we are for you. And we understand that even though this is a different kind of Mother's Day, we know that the responsibilities of being a mother and the privilege of being a mother before God is often overwhelming and never ending, and the task never seems to be done. And so we want to think specifically this morning from God's Word, and I want to encourage you out there who are listening as mothers. Now, of course, everything that we hear this morning from God's Word applies to everyone, but I want to specifically apply it to you as mothers. During this COVID-19 crisis, there's no doubt that being a mother has not only always been certain degrees of challenges, but even more so now, as we are even huddled in together, even more so now than we're used to. The job of a mother is never ending. You know, I think as a kid, I'm the youngest of five boys. My mom was a trooper when it came to raising all boys. And I think as a kid, you know, you're so going through life that you don't sometimes realize, and it's like us even today, you don't realize what you have. You don't realize how much sacrifice and time and love and care that your mother has given to you. It's one of the reasons why it's so atrocious to think of the idea of not having a mother that you could lean on. Because we understand that God has allowed this order of the family to be such a pillar to support us. When in Proverbs 6:20-23, it says, "My son, keep your father's commandment." Yes, it doesn't stop there. "And forsake not your mother's teaching. Bind them on your heart always. Fasten them around your neck." And so this morning, we want to say thank you to you as a mother, and you as a godly mother who has sought to raise your child and your children and continue to do so, even though knowing you are in need of the same gospel that you seek to live out to them. There's one quote, I forget who said it, but he basically said, "If you give me a group of mothers of a nation that have watched that nation change in a matter of a year, if you allow me to change the minds of mothers," because that's how powerful the influence of a mother is on a nation. But as you think this morning, you as a mother, what is it that you want your children to remember about you? Any of us can think of this in different ways, but specifically on Mother's Day, you, mother, what is it that you want your children to remember most about you? Do you want them to most remember that the meals were amazing? Do you want them most to remember about you that the house was always spotless? Do you want them most to remember about you that every time they asked, you were the greatest activity director on the face of the earth? Do you want them to know, most importantly about you, that you were the greatest educational teacher? What is it that you want your children to be most remembered about you? Because as we investigate this morning from God's Word, that for you as a mother, yes, the temptation is going to be to find your identity solely in being a mother. But I want you to see that even though you are a mother, your identity is found most importantly and should be prioritized around the fact that you are a disciple and follower of Jesus Christ. You see, when God created Eve in the garden, and Adam saw her for the first time, and he named her Eve, the mother of all the living, it wasn't that God just thought, you know, there's going to come a point in time where boys and men who sometimes act like boys don't know how to cook a meal. So we got to give them a mother. There's going to come a time when they're going to need laundry done, and who's going to do it? Well, we better give them a mother. There's going to be time that no one's going to be there to clean the toilet. Who's going to do that? Well, we better give them a mother. You were not created, mother, just to simply be a subservient person who is just there to do everything all the time for everyone. I know you do that, and we appreciate every bit of it, and it's underappreciated. But you are a disciple of Christ if you know him personally as your Savior. Your identity is not bound up in all these lists and all these tasks and all these things that you do. It's found in the fact that your greatest priority is to simply sit at Jesus' feet as his disciple. And as we're going to see this morning, yes, there's stuff to be done. We all have stuff that must be done. But our greatest priority is for us to sit regularly at Jesus' feet and hear him speak to us through his word. So let's do that this morning. Let's go to Luke chapter 10. Grab your Bibles. Grab your electronic device. Don't matter what you use as long as it's God's word. Luke chapter 10. We're going to look this morning at verses 38 to 42. And I want to encourage you as mothers and those of you that are listening in, this does apply to everyone. But I want to specifically apply this to you as mothers that are listening this morning. So Luke chapter 10, let's read verses 38 to the end of the chapter. Luke 10, starting in verse 38. Now as they, that's Jesus and the disciples, as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she went up to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her." So this morning, as I've already stated, for you listening out there as a mother, your most important priority is for you to sit at Jesus' feet and regularly have time that you are in his word as his follower, as his disciple. Now, I want you to realize this, that what is going on in this text is Jesus is exalting the position of being a woman, that in the ancient times, at this time, to sit at Jesus' feet and listen as a disciple, to be considered one who could be Jesus' pupil, his disciple, his follower, would have never happened in a Jewish culture. But Jesus was in the business of not following cultural traditions. He was in the business of following God's word. Women are not less than men. Women are equal in every way to men. And they are followers and heirs to eternal life and his gospel, just as anyone else is. Is there functions in the home created by God? Of course there is. But again, when God created Eve, it was he created another person to have fellowship with himself, not just to simply do someone's laundry, not just simply someone who is there to do all the things in the house so everybody else gets whatever they want. Now, you do a lot of that, Mom. I know it. And we appreciate it. And I have to say, if Mother's Day is the only time that we say thank you to you as a mother, shame be upon us, for your job is never ending. Your service to us is continual. So as we think about this text this morning, what I want to do is walk through the situation, and I want to talk about the sisters. So I want to walk through the situation that's laid out in Luke, and then I want to talk about the two sisters. So let's think about the situation. Starting in verse 38. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village. Now the they there helps us understand that Jesus was not alone. He was with his disciples. He was with a band of disciples. Jesus is in his public ministry. And here, as he's in his public ministry, he has gained a lot of fame and attention because he is publicly doing miracles at this point. So it says, as they went on their way, this band of disciples, Jesus entered a village. Now the question is, what village? Well, in the parallel passage in John chapter 11, we understand that this village is Bethany. And Bethany is real close to Jerusalem, only about a little less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. So as Jesus was traveling, he and his disciples didn't know where their next meal was going to come from, didn't know where they were going to lay their head down. They were simply just out ministering and relying on the good kindness and hospitality of people to allow them to stay. And so a need was starting to arise in this situation as they enter Bethany. Jesus needed somewhere to stay. Where are we going to stay, Jesus? And they must have something to eat. You need to have shelter and you need to have food. And so as Jesus was traveling, where is he going to get these things as he enters into Bethany? And who will offer them hospitality? Well, we see in the text, this situation has arisen. Jesus is going to do more teaching because he's doing teaching everywhere he goes. And someone steps forward, and this is where we start to get introduced to the sisters. Someone steps forward and says, "You can come to my house." It says, "And a woman named Martha welcomed him," Jesus, "and of course the disciples in the group, into her house. And she had a sister also called Mary." So now we get introduced to the sisters. The situation has arisen. Jesus is traveling. He needs somewhere to stay. He needs somewhere to eat. And now we get introduced to the sisters, Mary and Martha. What do we know about Mary and Martha? Well, both are sisters to Lazarus. You know the story of Lazarus? Jesus raised him from the dead there in Bethany in John chapter 11. These are Lazarus's two sisters. Both of them are from Bethany. Both are followers of Christ. So we're talking about believers. In John 11, if you were to read it, you would understand that Mary and Martha are both believers. Both followers of Christ on some level. Now, what are the differences? Well, Mary, this is not Mary Magdalene. It's not Mary Magdalene. This is a different Mary. This is Mary, the same Mary who wiped Jesus' feet with her hair back in Luke chapter 7 and other parallel passages in the Gospels. So this is the Mary in which when Jesus was in a house, it was Martha's house again, most likely, and she came and broke the ointment and began to wipe Jesus' feet with her hair. And the Pharisees said, if they knew who was touching him, if Jesus knew who was touching him, he would say, "Depart from me, for that woman is sinful." And Jesus said, "Leave her alone, because she's preparing me for burial, and what she has done will be talked about for generations." Mary was a woman who deeply understood her need for forgiveness. Martha, we understand, is the one who ran to Jesus in John chapter 11 and said, "Jesus, come, Lazarus has died." And Jesus said, "If you believe, I can help." And Martha says, "I do believe that you are the Christ." Mary's the one who wiped Jesus' feet. Martha's most likely the oldest for various reasons. And she often seems to be the one who's first to take initiative. She was the first one to run to Jesus and say, Lazarus has died. She's the one here stepping up saying, hey, come stay in my home. She seems to be the one who's quick to jump and help. So here they are, sisters. Now, Martha may be widowed at this point, and as I already mentioned, this may be her home that she's actually inviting Jesus and the disciples to. And so we're introduced to Martha, and what do we see going on? Well, we see two different things that the sisters are doing. So Martha welcomes him into her house, and if you can imagine this, Mom, of course you know this, and as she's inviting them in, all the things are running through her mind. I've got to get this ready. I've got to have enough chairs ready. I've got to have this much food. What do I have in the pantry? What am I going to make? Do we have enough of this? Do we have this? Can you get that? Oh, what are we going to do? Do we have enough? We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I don't know. We have to have some people sit outside. Martha has all of this running through her mind because she's invited them in. And Martha is frazzled. She's stressed out. She is burned out, as we'll see. She is just allowing herself to become so anxious and so stressed because of all the serving. So it says in verse 40 that Martha was distracted with much serving. And that word distracted is this idea that she's drawn away because, and she's pulled in every direction thinking about, what are we going to do here? What are we going to do there? What are we going to do here? And you can sympathize with this because if you imagine that in a culture, even like ours, if you invite someone to your home, you don't just sit there. You've invited them over for a meal. You've invited them over to get to know them, possibly to fellowship as Christians. And then you invite them in and then you do nothing. Culturally, of course, Martha's doing what we would think would be the cultural acceptable thing to do, and her mind is pulled in every direction. The idea of the word distracted, I mentioned it, she's pulled, she's dragged away, she's become distracted. And she was distracted by much serving. Now at this point, she's distracted by much serving, and she's keeping one eye on her sister, Mary, as well. So she's scrambling back and forth, but all the time, she's seeing what her sister, Mary, is doing. And what is it that Mary's doing? Well, in verse 39, it says, and she had a sister called Mary. And what is Mary doing? She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. So Mary's distracted by much serving. She's running back and forth, but all along she's seen and starting to well up in her an annoyance, an irritation towards her sister Mary. And you can imagine the temptation. She's doing all this serving, and there's Mary just simply sitting at Jesus' feet, quietly soaking in his teaching. And you can imagine Martha, she's thinking, you know, well, sure, must be nice. Wish I could do that. I'm trying to get to that point where I can actually have some quiet time with Jesus, but here I am doing all the serving, and if she would just help, we could get this done faster. There's way too much to do to be just sitting there listening. And she's getting irritated that she can't get the help from Mary that she believes she needs as her sister. So Martha starts to become angry and annoyed and irritated at her sister as Mary simply sits at Jesus' feet and listens to his teaching. And we have quite a stark contrast of women in this text. One woman is the distracted disciple. So if you're writing this down, I think Martha would be what I would call the distracted disciple. She has good intentions. There's ways in which the things that she's doing are not necessarily wrong, yet she's distracted because she needs to spend time simply with Jesus and not be so distracted and consumed and anxious. It says in the text, we will see that Jesus will tell her, you're being anxious. And we've been talking a lot about that through our Unshaken series, that anxiety is this care on another level. So intense her anxiety and stress that it started to tempt her to become irritated at her sister. And there's Mary sitting at the Lord's feet, listening to Jesus' teaching. So we have the distracted disciple of Martha. And then when we think of Mary, I think of Mary as the reflective disciple. It's almost as if for Mary at this moment, yeah, there's all kinds of hustle and bustle and there's all this stuff and all these tasks and all these things that can consume her mind, but she's so enthralled with who Jesus is as her Savior that it's if the focal point is on Jesus and all the other things have just kind of gone into blurry vision. And it's just Jesus in focus. And she easily tunes it out because she has understood that she is forgiven. She has understood that the Savior of the world is in our house. There is no reason to think about all this other stuff. I need to spend time with Him. She's a reflective disciple. Now, as I mentioned, for Mary to be sitting there could be perceived as culturally rude. Maybe Martha was thinking that. Doesn't she understand how rude this is? We've got to get these people food. They're in our house. Because as I mentioned, it's odd to invite a guest into your home for a meal and fellowship and then just sit there. But now we see the response of Jesus. We see the situation, the sisters, and then the response of Jesus. Look in the text. Martha is so tempted to be irritated that she finally can't take it anymore. And in her mind, she thinks, I know that Jesus would not agree with this. It seems to be that's what she's thinking. Jesus is on my side on this one. He needs to tell her to help me, and I know he'll do it. So she went up to Jesus in verse 40 and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Do you not care? Kind of reminds us on a different level when Jesus was sleeping in the boat and the disciples went down there during the storm and said, don't you care? It's a different kind. Same statement. Martha comes to him and says, don't you care that my sister has left me alone? That word alone, very emphatic. I'm the only one. Perhaps Martha was the only one trying to get everything ready. My sister has left me alone. Tell her then to help me. And it seems that Martha, in her mind, believed that Jesus would do three things, possibly. That she would put him in a position of being potentially insensitive. Like, Lord, don't you care? Like, if you don't do something about this, doesn't it kind of show that you potentially might be insensitive to the fact that I'm over here working my tail off? Lord, don't you care? It might also mean that Martha's concerned that she's just left alone to do all this. And what is really left is a demand that Jesus speak to Mary and essentially reprimand her for sitting there at his feet, soaking in his teaching when there's stuff to be done. And I have to tell you, moms, this really does apply to you as a mother, to any of us who become frantic, but specifically because, moms, there are so many ways in which you could convince yourself there's too many other things to do than to simply be at Jesus' feet. It's easy to do that. Are you potentially, mom, one who, before you can spend time alone with God, you have to get the things checked off your list? Unless the things are checked off your list, you cannot spend time with Jesus. If that's the case, mom, you've got your priorities mixed. Those other things, as we'll see in Jesus' response, are not more important than your time alone with Jesus. So Jesus does quite the opposite of what Martha thought. Verse 41, but the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha. He says her name twice. And if you could in a sense, just picture, it's as if Jesus is so kindly just simply saying, Martha, I love you, but you must understand. Look at verse 41. Martha, Martha, you are so anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. So he speaks directly to her heart that she's anxious and stressed and troubled about all these surfacey things when Jesus is simply saying, whatever you make us doesn't matter. Whatever your house looks like, it doesn't matter. However you serve us from a hospitality, cultural standpoint, it doesn't matter. One thing is necessary. Oh, do we need this truth in our culture? Because you as a mother, it's not about the fact that on Facebook, you and your family, you look like the perfect family, and you look like the perfect mother who's holding it all together. You post your plans for your meals. You do all these things, and so people see that you are a mother. There's a lot of good things in those, but that's not what makes you who you are. What makes you who you are is that Jesus wants you to go higher, to realize you're a disciple, not just a mother who does all these things and frantically runs around doing all these other things for other people. So Jesus says, listen, you're troubled about all these things. Not all these things are bad, but there's one thing that's necessary. And Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. So what he's simply saying in a really kind and gentle way is, listen, Martha, you're actually wrong. Mary has chosen the right thing. To make me and alone time with me her priority is more important than the task to be done. Essentially, it's as if Jesus is saying, listen, you can give us bread and water. We don't care. We're not concerned that you perfectly serve us. What I'm most concerned about is that you realize that I'm all that you need. You don't need to be this picture perfect whatever. I want you to just simply follow Mary's example to realize what matters most is to sit at my feet, get into God's word, and grow. Because you know what actually happens? We tend to put tasks and then worship, when really we should reflect and we should worship, and our love for God should overflow that we end up serving. Which is really an encouragement for us this morning, that whether you're a mother here listening in this morning or not, our priority as a Christian should be that we have regular alone time with God. We don't just let the day and all the plates start spinning and then we think, well, God, alone time, his word, prayer, oh well. What do you want your children, Mom, to remember of you? Do you want them to remember, oh, the food was good, the laundry was clean, the house wasn't a mess? Or do you want them to remember that there were many times that they were catching you, no, I'm reading my Bible right now. Yep, I'm going to spend time with God right now. That my mom was a person who spent time alone with Jesus. Because that's what matters most. Yes, is there things to be done? Are there tasks to be done? Of course. But one thing is necessary, Jesus says. And it's me and spending time with me on a regular basis. Now, we can't go this far without actually also speaking to those who are husbands out there. Because we want our wives, who are mothers, to embrace this truth. But often, we as husbands don't embrace this truth that our wives need to spend more time alone with Jesus. Husband, you need to help your wife and your children see that what matters most is mom gets time alone in God's word. Now, we talk a lot about around here, and our culture talks about this idea. You need me time. But see, when our culture talks about me time, what they mean is, I need time to myself to do what makes me happy, and I want to do that for myself. It's putting myself first, and I need some time to do that. Well, when we talk about spending time alone with the Lord and helping our wives and you, Mom, to get time to do this, we're not talking about me time. We're talking about Jesus time. We're talking about time alone with the Lord, in which you can do what Mary did. Because it's all about motive. Why do you want time alone? Well, often it should be because you want to be silent and reflective and to simply ask God through His Word to speak to you so you can know how to grow, know how to change, know how to adore Jesus more. Because Christianity is not all about doing, doing, doing. Christianity is about delighting. And the more you delight in God, the more you'll actually do for God. It's really not about doing. Doing's just like, yeah, of course I'm going to do that because I delight in Jesus. But Mary has chosen in this text what is necessary. This is not about Mary's better than Martha. This is not about that Martha in every respect in this text is wrong. She's wrong to be irritated. She's wrong to judge her sister, yes. But she's not necessarily wrong to be hospitable. She's not necessarily wrong to say, hey, there's some things to be done. It's that she's prioritizing one over the other. This is about the fact that one must never, Mom, you must never prioritize business over quiet worship and listening to God. You must never prioritize, I have to get all this stuff done in order to spend time with Jesus. There might be times, guess what? If I were to come home and my house is a mess and Amy says to me, but I had to spend time with God and I got alone with Him, so what? One thing is necessary: to be at Jesus' feet as His disciple. So as we think this morning at this text, as we think about how much we appreciate you mothers, my encouragement to you from God's Word is, are you finding regular alone time with God? Because ultimately, your goal shouldn't just be to be a mother, it should be to be a disciple of Christ who is a godly mother. And the way to do that is to have a thriving relationship with Jesus Christ. So for you, are you finding time alone with God? For those of us in our mother's lives, are you helping her see and help encouraging that you don't believe she just exists to serve you? She exists as a fellow heir of eternal life who needs to have regular time with Jesus in His Word. So Mom, we appreciate you. We love all that you have done for us. We're grateful to the Lord the way in which every mother has been used in this church to help children, to serve. And as we think of this very unique Mother's Day, it's an opportunity for us to take time regularly, not just one day, and appreciate and say thank you to the Lord for the mother and the godly mothers that He has put in our lives. Let's close together in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we think about the mothers that you have put in our lives, many mothers who have shared the gospel with their children, Lord, as we think about the countless ways in which we have been served, Lord, we are grateful because we know ultimately every good and perfect gift comes from you. But Lord, I do pray for each mother that is out there. Lord, I pray that first of all, they would understand their need to have you as their Savior. And second, Lord, that you would help them to see that one thing is necessary: to simply be a follower and one who regularly gets in your Word. So, Lord, I pray that you would use your Word as it has gone forth. May it encourage hearts, and may this day be a day of which we remember how grateful we are for all the good gifts you've given to us. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.